fluid flow. So we have been discussing the solution of linear systems, and last time we saw the alternating line Gauss-Seidel method. That is also the topic of exercise 9. There is an important thing that we should know, and that is what I call the convergence theorem. And you will find the proof in textbooks on the numerical solution of linear systems. If the matrix A is diagonally dominant, irreducible, then the Jacobi and the Gauss-Seidel iteration methods that we saw last time. They are very similar. The difference is that in Gauss-Seidel we update directly the unknowns. Don't wait until everything is finished. So then these methods will converge, and that is meant in the sense of what we discussed last time, and that is in that case to the solution of our linear system, which is A inverse B, for any starting vector x0. So that is the important message. So diagonal dominance, that is important. Therefore, we are looking at that, and you also looked at that in exercise 8. So if we have then a diagonally dominant irreducible that we can, it can be reduced to say matrices that are of smaller size, so that means the off diagonals will have some value. So what we do then, we iterate until convergence that we can check, as we will do in exercise 9. And that is now, well, please correct me if I'm now taking wrong numbers here. Is that 12? Is that right? Last one was 11.
No.
Thank you. So that the change of the solution at the new iteration, k plus 1, minus the solution at the old iteration, and then we can take any norm, for example, the 2 norm. If that is smaller than some tolerance times the norm that we get from the solution at the first iteration minus the solution that we compute with the starting guess. And for example, as we do in the exercise 9, we have a tolerance here of 10 to the minus 6. That is in exercise 9. Take that as an example. And the 2 norm is then defined in the way following, that we say the we would take the norm, the 2 norm of phi. Phi is now a vector of our unknowns in all the grid points, and that is then equal to the volume of each cell, delta x times delta y, times the sum over all I from 1 to n I, and the sum j from 1 to n j. So here I'm using my notation, where the boundaries are at I equal to 0, at n I plus 1, j equal to 0, and j n j plus 1. And then we would take the unknown at the each grid point squared, sum over all them, and then in the end take the the square root. Okay, so then we have this criterion, and if we do that, we will find out that the number of iterations that we need to converge for these methods is both for the Jacobi and for the Gauss-Seidel iteration methods is of the order n squared, is the number of unknowns. In this case, it would be ni times nj. So the more unknowns we have, the more iterations it will take. However, the Gauss-Seidel is about twice as fast as Jacobi. So you need about only half the number of iterations for Gauss-Seidel compared to Jacobi. Now, there is an important thing to note about how we correct our solution from one iteration to the next one. And that is under the heading over and under relaxation. That will play an important role when we get to solving the incompressible Navier-Stokes equations. So what we do here is, in general, we correct the solution so that we say the new iteration computed is equal to the old iteration plus 1 times the change, phi k plus 1 minus phi k. So we have the solution, and then usually we update directly in the Gauss-Seidel, or we don't do that. But in any case, we add the change with the factor 1. And under and over relaxation means that we add under relaxation less than 1. Over relaxation means we add more than 1 in the change. So that is the standard way, but so that is changed. So instead of that, instead of this, we change the solution, the iteration. We change. By a fraction omega. So instead of changing by a fraction 1, we change by a fraction omega. And that is then the following. That is then 13, that we compute the iteration, the new iteration, k plus 1, by doing a computer assignment. Now, this is not a mathematical equal, but a computer assignment, like you do in programming. You override what is coming on the right by this. So we have the old iteration, and then we add omega times the change, k plus 1 times phi k. So then, so I say this explicitly, so that is here in the sense of a computer assignment. And then we have the choice, if we have omega equal to 1, then we do what we generally do. That is, there is nothing different, but if we have omega between 0 and 1, then we have under relaxation. So omega between 0 and 1, then we have under relaxation. Then we change less than usual. And that is often used for when we solve problems that arise when we use implicit methods for hyperbolic and parabolic problems. implicit method, then we get linear systems, and then it turns out that under relaxation can be helpful. So that is one thing, and the other is if omega is between 1 and 2, and that is called over relaxation. Then we change more than usual. And that is usually used for elliptic problems that we are discussing at the moment. So we'll come back to that when we discuss the solution of the incompressible Navier-Stokes equations. There, relaxation plays an important role. Just to mention one example of this is successive over-relaxation. SOR is the acronym, then that can be used for very special elliptic problems. Only few of them, but when it can be used, then it has a nice property that the number of iterations you need for convergence is not going with n squared, but with n. So this is much faster than Jacobi or Gauss-Seidel. So that is essentially a combination of point Gauss-Seidel with a very clever choice of omega. There is some theory about that, which we don't treat here. Neither shall we go into detail in the other methods that I just want to mention, which you can read in the textbook by Fletcher, Tanhill, and Anderson. There is a lot of good literature also around for numerical linear algebra, so that's the topic. So I just mentioned these other methods that are useful also in CFD, that is incomplete LU decomposition. ILU. As you remember, when we do LU decomposition for a banded system, we get fill-in. And here you stop to get fill-in, and then you treat that the rest that is not corresponding then to A at the old iteration level. And examples that you can read in the textbook are SIP, which is strongly implicit procedure. LU decomposition with what you have in the band, in the banded system. In our case, we have a pentadiagonal system. Okay, and then a very nice method is also the following, that is conjugate gradient method. And that relies on the idea of transforming the problem of solving a linear system to finding a minimum. And it involves matrix vector multiplications and dot products of vectors. So that there's lots of preconditioning you can use with that. But it is restricted, unfortunately, to only symmetric and positive definite matrices, so they have to have special properties. But it can be generalized. And the generalization is called GMRES, just that you have heard that generalized minimum residual method. So that is falls into this class. This does not have this restriction, but there is less theory about that. And finally, I would like to mention a very powerful method that is class of methods called multigrid methods. So this method relies on that you can smooth the error on the fine grid. When it's smooth, you can transfer the error to the coarse grid and correct the method, correct the solution there. And you can go back to just in the end to like one unknown in the end, and then go up. So these methods are, multigrid methods are, when they are done well, it's not so easy. Always for our problems it is easy. Then you have O of n operations for the convergence. So and the, say the rule of thumb by Ami Brandt, who made this method popular in the West, it comes from Fedorenko in the Soviet Union. The rule by Ami Brandt is you should need of the order of 10 iterations to get converged. If you don't have that, then there is something wrong. So then you have a brief overview over methods that we can still use to solve linear systems. And the method that we are now using for exercise 9, the alternating line Gauss-Seidel method, that would be a useful method to do the smoothing on the fine grids, for example. So it is not in vain what we are doing here. But we want to move on to get now, after we have now looked at solving solution linear systems arising, I have it here up from our chapter on steady diffusion problems arising by the discretization of steady 2D diffusion problems with the finite volume method. So now we want to move on, and we want now go back to our transport equations, our conservation laws, and now we want to add convection. Before we had only diffusion and source term, now we want to add on that convection. So that brings us then to chapter 13, and that is then the finite body method for steady. So we are still steady, but now we have convection. That is the new thing, convection diffusion problems. So we consider a conservation law for steady state. So conservation law. That was that we discussed in chapter 11. That was actually the one that had the number one, the very first ones. We had a class of those. And we look at that for steady state. That means we have no time derivative. And we look in the integral form. So then we get the following. Background is again the same thing as we have been discussing all the time. We have a control volume omega, we have a boundary d omega, and we have an outer unit normal vector n that is a normal to the tangent. And then we have an integral over the boundary of the domain d omega, where we consider the convection of the quantity phi. And that is then rho phi, and here we have then the normal velocity component, u dot n, use the velocity vector and the unit outer normal vector. And that is a surface integral. So here we describe convection, and that is then new, that we did not have before. in the discussion of steady problems. And on the right-hand side, we have still the diffusive flux. That is also an integral over the boundary, and that is the one that we have discussed in chapter 11. The diffusion coefficient times the gradient of our unknown phi, and then outer, the inner product with the outer unit normal vector n dA, and then we have also a source term. So this here describes then the diffusion, the diffusive flux over the boundary, and then we have also a source term. That is the integral, it's a volume integral, so it's over omega, and our function describing the source term is S phi dV, so that is then the source. So that is the equation that we consider now. And an example for that is the steady energy. In the energy equation, our unknown phi is the temperature, and our diffusion coefficient, it depends how you formulate it, but when we want to get it in this form, we take it as the thermal conductivity, K divided by the specific heat at constant pressure. And then we have an example for that. In differential conservative form, we can express this integral form in the usual way. So that is in differential conservative form. Gauss theorem. And Gauss theorem requires some differentiability of our fluxes here and this. Well, it's most critical for then for the convection usually. And then we get the differential form. And that is then the divergence of rho phi u. Density, our unknown quantity phi, for example temperature, times the velocity vector u. And on the right hand side we have that what we had discussed already in chapter 11, the term describing diffusion, that is then the divergence of gamma gradient phi, and we have here then the S phi, that is the term coming describing the source term. And you see, by doing that, we get another derivative. So here we had no derivative for the convective flux, but when we do this integration here, we get in the derivative. So that is what you know already from basic fluid mechanics. When you do the control volume analysis, you have this form. When you do the differential analysis, you have this form. So now we do the discretization here of the different terms, and we make an assumption here. So we assume something that is related to incompressible flow. So we assume that the steady continuity equation holds. That is then preparing for the solution of the incompressible Navier-Stokes equations, where we have that steady continuity equation holds. And that means that we have now again first the integral form, that is integral over the boundary, and then the mass flow, u dot n, over the boundary, the net mass flow is zero. So it means the mass that is flowing into the control volume over the boundary is the same as flowing out. So now we do then the discretization of the different terms, and the interesting one is for the convection, because the diffusion, the source term, we have already discussed. You see, if we would use here the Gauss theorem, we would get the divergence of the rho u is equal to zero. The argument is you do it, you get the volume integral, and then the volume is arbitrary, and then the integrand must be zero. Okay, but we focus now on the finite volume method for the discretization, and we do the same, we do it in a similar way as we did for the diffusion equation. We start with 1D. So it's 1D steady convection. Then we make the usual assumptions. We have, in that case, a constant cross-section. Imagine we have, for example, a pipeline with a circular cross-section. And we imagine that is our control volume, omega p. And here we have our eastern face, and that is now the area of the eastern face. Here we have the western face and the area, and the cross-section is the same, so that is constant, so also the area is constant. And the new thing that we assume here is that we have velocity. That is the new thing that we did not have before, that we have now velocity components at the faces. So we have then u w, and we have u west, u east. So that is the new thing. And so now we want to express our equation 1 for this particular problem. First, the coordinate system I have to give you. That is the same as we did before. We have the x direction as the y direction, and then the cross in the cross section, we have the coordinates y and z. And we assume now in 1D that the cross section is constant. Cross-section constant, and then that we therefore also the area, area A is constant, that is the area of the cross-section, and we assume that our unknown is only a function of x, so that in each cross-section the phi is constant, it's only varying with x. Now we make the same assumption as we did in 1D diffusion. We assume that we have no diffusion over the case. And that is, diffusion over the case is either well neglected or not there. If it's insulated, for example, for a thermal problem, or it is taken care of by the source term. One dimension, the equation that I just took away, can be expressed as now we have the convective part, and now we also remark that the velocity is constant over the whole phase, at the eastern and the western phase. So then we can compute these integrals, because rho v times phi is constant in this plane. And we have then just this value that we have there times the area. That is then the surface integral over the convective flux over this phase. And similar here. And here we'll get a minus sign because the normal is in the negative x direction. So then we get the following. We get the rho u, and we get the area in here, phi, at the eastern phase. So that is the mass flow of the quantity phi over the eastern boundary. And minus the it's not the mass flow, it's the flow of the quantity phi. The flow of the quantity phi of the eastern phase. And then we have minus the flow of the convective flow of the quantity phi over the western phase. So that is then the discretization of the convection. And if we have a flow that is in the x direction, then we have no component in the cross flow direction. So there is no convective flow in the cross flow direction. So we have only then convection, contribution of the convective flux in the x direction. For the diffusive flux, we do just the same as we did in chapter 11, when we only considered diffusion. Then we have a diffusive flux over the eastern phase, that is this one, and minus the diffusive flux over the western phase, and we have to consider the source term. And that is average source over the whole volume times the volume of the control volume. So that is then, and here we have used that we have no diffusive flux over the case. So we have only diffusive flux over the ends. And the continuity equation that we assumed, that can be expressed as follows. So that is equation 3. There we have then that the net mass flow over the boundary of omega is 0. And in our case, we have then only flow over the western, over the eastern, the western faces. The mass flow over the eastern face is rho ua. Again, u is constant. Rho is constant at all, and minus the mass flow over the western boundary. These are small letters. That is 0. So that is the assumption that we have been using regarding the validity of the continuity equation. And now we introduce some quantities that I think were first introduced by Patanka to make the writing in the end a little bit more compact. We do that also, so we introduce variables that we call F. And capital F and capital D, and the capital F is called convective mass flux. It's essentially the mass flow we usually just say what it is meant per unit area here. So that's convective mass flux. And the other quantity, the D quantity, is called diffusion conductance. It's just diffusion conductance. And that is done in the following way, so respectively, that we do it following. We say that that we call the FT, that is the convective mass flux, simply the rho mu at Eastern base. And we call the FW the rho mu at the Western face. And the diffusion conductance dV, that is then the coefficient gamma E, that is the diffusion coefficient at the eastern face, divided by the distance between the nodes P and E. And the diffusion conductance at the western face is then the diffusion coefficient at the western face, divided by the distance between the western node W and the center node P. So we imagine we have now neighbors. Our control omega P and E and W. So then we have this notation here that will then in the end simplify when we write down the coefficients for our problem. Okay, so now we want to look at this equation here a little bit in more detail. We can take it as it is, like it's done in the skeleton, or we can divide by the area, because the area is constant for 1D. You see we have it here, 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 and we can also divide this. Then we get here S bar times delta XP. So, dividing by A, which is constant, that is the constant cross section area. So dividing in equations 4 and 5, we have them here. And approximating and using the approximations dx and in that case what we discussed is the S bar delta xp in 4 as in chapter 11. So then this is the uniform part of the source term plus SP times phi P, for example, this part here. Then we obtain the following. That is the equation 8, corresponding to the number 4. And then we use these notations here. The convective mass flux at the eastern face times the unknown at the eastern face minus convective mass flux at the western face and the unknown at the western face is equal to the diffusion conductance. You see that here we have divided by A and we get here the gamma at the eastern face and here we get the distance between P and between E minus P. So that is then this guy here is entering. and that is then times the unknown in E minus the unknown in P. Likewise, we do it at the western face. Also there we get then the diffusion conductance dW, and there we have a difference in P of phi and in W, capital W. And we have the source term approximation, and that is then the uniform source term plus SP times phi P. So that is then our form that we get for the steady transport equation. For the continuity equation, after dividing by A, we simply get that the difference in the convective mass flux Fe minus Fw is zero. So then we have these expressions here. So that means what we can see here is that F must be constant. Fe is equal to Fw. So that is something that we shall use. And we shall moreover use that the velocity u at the faces, east, west, and so on, is actually constant, but that it is given actually. So we know from equation 9 that the convective mass flux is constant, and what we now assume that this value is actually given. That's what I just said. So we assume here that the F, which is equal to Fe, Fw, is given. In the next chapter, we shall compute F. But here we assume it is given. And the finite volume methods that we shall discuss then after the break for 8 differ in the approximation of the convective terms. So this is given, this is given. How we approximate the phi e and the phi w. That's the difference. The rest we have already decided on using the sample finite volume method for the diffusion. So these finite volume methods differ in the approximation of phi e and phi w. So that is something that we then discuss after the break. Before we get into the break, I would like to ask the people from the reference group to come discuss with me the time for the next meeting. Okay, then we stop here.